What's going on, ladies and gents? Dalibor here for T3G, along with Hades.
Yo.
And this is Dan, our third guy for this particular podcast. Yes, we're doing yet another podcast. Hashtag Tangents. Check us out on SoundCloud.
Yeah, and
today, SoundCloud. Today we're talking about... Well, we're going to talk about gaming. In particular, well,
we're gonna start talking about gaming.
We're gonna start talking about gaming, and we'll see what happens, because that's kind of the nature of our conversations, and that's why it's called
end
tangents.
Up everywhere.
That's why it's called tangents.
That is why it's called tangents.
What I want to talk about is this just happened with we were talking about this in Titanfall. It happened. Right. I think the start of it, as far as I can know, as far as I can think back, is when Mass Effect 3 came out, and everyone lost their minds with the ending. And everyone's like, oh, it's just a crap ending. No one likes it. And EA caved, or was whoever makes it.
I believe it is.
That was EA.
EA. Oh, yeah. EA's the publisher, but like, sure. Whatever, right. The studio. Anyway, they caved, and they made another ending. They made like, oh, let's...
BioWare, I believe.
BioWare, yeah, that's the ones. They caved, and they're like, let's make another ending. And some people still weren't happy with that, but whatever. So they were like, all right, well, all our fans are pissed. Let's appease them by giving them this other content that we didn't really intend to make in the first place. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that was kind of the start of this spiral, where now you've got companies kind of being in either one of two camps. They either don't care. It's like, oh, you can complain as much as you want. We're not going to do anything about it. You know, like we've got our plans. We're going to do what we want. Screw you guys. Or you've got companies like now, you know, we're talking about Titanfall. I feel like a lot of the stuff, yeah, that definitely has to fix that. The screen just turned off on me, so we couldn't see you
us.
I feel like Titanfall, I feel like they let too many things get changed based on people's complaints, when I feel like it wasn't necessary.
Mm.
And so, you know, and anything and everything in between, because you had... Pokemon Go was another huge one where it was like, oh, hey, the tracking is broken. Oh, okay, we're just going to take it out. Not like, right. Hey, we're working on it, or like nothing, not a word from them. It's just next update, it was gone, and everyone's even more outraged, and now they got to like pick up the pieces and try to be like, oh, no, we still love you guys, you know, we're still doing it for you. But it's like, bear with us while we launch. And I was kind of like, that's a crazy, crazy move.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But, like, what do you guys think on that? I mean, do you think companies should do what their fans want them to do? Or should they, like, all right, this is our plan. We're going to stick to our guns. We're just going to execute our plan the way we want.
I mean, I can let Dan go on this first if he wants to.
This is difficult. On one hand, you have to consider that every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And when your video games are your storytelling medium, characters that you love, characters that you want to live, are going to die.
Right. Because that's my thing. I never played Mass Effect.
Mm.
So to me, like, it didn't matter. Like... It ended the way it ended. Once I get to play it, I'll see how it ended. And then when I heard that they created a whole new thing, I was like, well, why?
Well, that was... People always want to keep that idea of a sequel alive. You know, oh, Major Shepard's dead, but he's not really dead. And...
You know, spoilers for those of you who...
Colonel Shepard.
Somehow haven't.
You know, whatever his rank may be, Captain... as far as companies pandering or, you know, just being like, hey, screw you to, you know, the customer, basically, you have to strike a balance with that as well. Whereas, you know, it's kind of like, in every video game, every shooter I've ever played, it feels like the guns are underpowered or the bullets don't get there as fast as they should. And that is definitely a thing for me.
Right.
But... At the same time, the game is the game, and just because, you know, Dan from wherever, you know, wants the bullet, you know, to get there as fast as it really should,
right,
doesn't really matter.
I mean, and you've even got some authority on the subject. You shoot guns, like, for sport.
Yes.
And it's something of a subject matter that you are an authority on. And so for you to say, all right, well, it's not getting there as fast as it should, or it's not as powerful as it should be, you know, that's something that, like, that's kind of a thing where if they're going for, like, hyper-realism, like with the Modern Warfare series, that was one of those things where when you had weapons that weren't at the level where they should have been, or were way higher with it than they should have been, then you're kind of like, well, this is, you know, it's Modern Warfare. Like, if it's, and when they went into Advanced Warfare and Black Ops 3 and all that stuff, where it's just like futuristic-ish, I didn't care, because then it's like, well, those are future weapons, I don't know what they do. So they do whatever they made them do. Whereas with the Modern Warfare games, I feel like you had those moments where it's like, I fired an AR-15. So on, like, the, when the M4 and the, when the M4 and the M16 do the same amount of damage, I'm kind of like, I feel like there's a little difference that should be happening there.
Well, in terms of stopping power and all that, there isn't much of a difference between, like, a 16-inch barrel and a 20-inch barrel. It's the same bullet. What, where it comes in is velocity.
Right.
So, out of a 20-inch barrel, the 5.56 round was made to be fired out of a 20-inch barrel. And so, it gets there just a skosh faster than if it's fired out of a 16-inch barrel. So, the idea that the two guns would do the exact same damage is accurate. It's just that one of them has a little bit more of an advantage in range, possibly.
Gotcha.
Or accuracy. But one gun is better for one job and one is better for another.
Sure.
So you don't want to be inside a building in, like, really tight quarters with a rifle that's, you know, 36 inches long.
Right. You just need that space.
Yeah, and so there's that, but, well, that's
I just mean that, like, it's one of those things, like, if you went to them and said, hey, guys, you know, as an educated person on this subject matter, here's my opinion on what should be added or changed or modified or whatever, that's something I feel like if people like that came to them, I feel like that would be fine. Because it's like,
well,
if you're talking about science and, like, if somebody's saying, oh, we're going to be ultra-realistic for, you know, this time period. Let's say if it's a period, you know, period set game like Battlefield 1 that just came out. Battlefield 1 is like World War 1. And if somebody comes in and they're like, well, this would not, like, if you're really trying to represent this time period, and somebody was like, this was not around. Like, this weapon didn't exist, or this vehicle didn't exist. Like, if you're trying to represent this accurately, this is something that doesn't make sense.
Well, and that's the thing is that, video games can be a medium for telling some history, but at the same time, they have to be fun.
Right.
And so, it's no fun if, you know, a guy runs around the corner and I just blow his head off and that's it. Because everybody, in the interest of fair play, everybody has to have a chance.
Right. I mean, that makes sense.
And so, but there's a limit. Like, when I empty whole magazines into people and they're like, just, you know, whatever, let's say I'm behind him and,
you mean
know,
Halo? You mean the entirety of the Halo series?
Yeah, pretty much. And I unload on them with everything I've got, and then they turn around and punch me in the face, and I die. That's a bit of a problem
you've
for
seen,
me.
You've seen some of that in Black Ops 3, right, Hans?
I mean, you know, it happens.
Like, oh, three shotgun blasts to the chest and face? Still not dead? Okay, that's fine.
Oh, you got up to me and you knifed me? Man, you're amazing.
Yeah, those throwing knives are like the nuclear weapon. Like, why right? Don't we all just have throwing knives?
Just a knife fight across the whole map.
Nuclear.
You don't ever leave. Just throw knives over until we hit
each
other.
Like, speaking, I don't know, I'm not an authority on the subject, but if a knife lands in your foot,
it's not going to kill you.
It's probably not going to kill you.
Not right away.
Immediately.
Yeah. You might even be able to hobble on.
Yeah, you might be able to, like,
You might still be able to shoot a weapon, maybe.
Unless
you might be able to make it
die
a
of
block.
Embarrassment because you were the only guy on a battlefield that got hit by a throwing knife.
That's like, yeah, you got, like, missiles and explosions, and you got hit by a knife. In the foot.
Right.
So, either way, Harris, what are your thoughts on this?
I think, here's the thing, I think, yeah, I agree with Dan, I think there's, like, there's got to be a balance, right? Some companies, they take it to an extreme. They're like, oh, shit, people are complaining. Let's change it. And it's completely the opposite. But they thought, you know, they kind of went too far, right? And then there are some companies that just don't even care. They don't. They just hear you. And they're like, meh, whatever. This is how it's going to be. I think you gotta play a balance act, right? You gotta. I think one of the biggest companies, and the reason I'm saying this one is because I'm playing them, but not because I'm a big fan. But I think one of the biggest companies that really kind of takes into account what everybody wants and tries to please everybody, and not always necessarily succeeds in pleasing everybody, but at the same time they definitely implemented a lot of things that people wanted, is Blizzard. Blizzard does. They do constantly betas, they do constantly PTRs, and they take your feedback and they work with you and they make sure that they're listening to everybody who's playing the games and trying to deliver as close to possible what people want, you know? So I think it has to be a balancing act. Like, for instance, for Mass Effect, that was such a huge... huge negative impact from the fan base that if they just ignored it and just went with it, I think that would have been bad a business decision, because it wasn't just like a few people hated it. It was so bad that people just all around were just talking about it, how bad the ending is and how everybody's disappointed, everybody of the franchise that were fans of it from the beginning. So I think it just... it depends on the situation. I think you still, the way Mass Effect did it, I think wasn't actually too wrong, right? You still have the ending they wanted, but then they gave you also that other ending that you wanted. So if you weren't happy with the ending that you got, well, here's another ending for a little bit more gameplay. So,
right.
You know, it's, I think you just have to, I think the best route for stuff like this is, you have to sit down and take, you know, in Blizzard's terms, it's beta and public test ROMs, right? And then they take all that feedback and try to do everything they can. Obviously, you're not going to get always what you want, but, you know, it's all about listening and getting as close as possible to that. So I think what the ultimate thing is sit down and create feedback forums or create some kind of system where you can get feedback from your customers and see what's hitting and what's not, and kind of work towards obviously what's hitting, because if you work towards that, you're going to have more success. And it kind of goes into like a lot of other things. This is where the tangent aspect goes into it, because you know, we've seen this not just for video games, but we've seen this for movies, we've seen this from shows, and we've seen this from comic books. People just taking it to an extreme. People just getting pissed off. And I like a little bit kind of what's happening with the comic books, because they're not necessarily giving in, but although you never know, right? Because they'll never tell you if they changed it due to the backlash continuing right. The story, you know, they'll never say, oh, we changed, this is how we always wanted to go, you know, you don't know that, but at the same time, you know, they kind of tell you, it's like, listen, this is just the first issue, we know where we're going with this, you just need to let the story play out. And that's true for some things, you know, for stuff like comics or TV shows, you can't be so extreme to like, we've seen, I mean, it's getting so bad that people are sending death threats to creators.
That's
messed up. Like, we get it, everybody's passionate for what we, you know, take in as entertainment, because stories, you know, they take us out of the norm, they take us into a world that we're not accustomed to, and it so essentially gets us away from the reality that we're in, and that's great. But like, you can't take that and have, you know, I understand having the passion for it and the love for it, but you can't take all that and then be like, oh, this didn't go my way, time to, you know, start throwing out some threats out there. Like, that's an awful way of trying to send out constructive criticism. You know what I'm saying?
I completely agree, man. When I started hearing that people were getting death threats, people get doxxed, like all their personal information goes out there.
Yeah,
it's like insane. Oh, you don't like something, so you should just then harm it. And right. It's like, I say this a lot. Like, the internet gave everybody an opportunity to voice their opinion.
Yeah.
But just because you can doesn't mean that you should.
Absolutely.
Like,
absolutely.
Okay, cool. And you're fine if you're mad, but, like, to then take that and go to the next level and, like, threaten somebody's life or put their personal information. I mean, just like what happened with Leslie Jones last week, where they literally took over her entire site, put up her driver's license, like, super, super personal information, and, like, nudes and all that stuff. And it's like, really? You guys didn't like that movie that much? Or maybe, if, you know, some people are saying that it might have been people who were mad that she was part of the reason that what that one dude got kicked off Twitter, which there's 1,000 social media platforms, so, like, who cares if he's not on Twitter?
I was going to say, I mean, that none of that matters. I mean, it's just here's the thing. I wouldn't necessarily say, you know, it gave everybody a, you know, voice, and maybe your opinion shouldn't be out there. It's not that. I would say, you know, try to think about what you're trying to say, because just going lashing out with pure, like, hatred is not a way of getting a good word across. Because all that anybody's going to see on that is that you're either extremely hateful or you might have a problem and you need to get it looked at.
Right.
Well, yeah. So, it also does great harm to the community.
Well, it does huge harm to the community, because creators then don't want to create because they're worried how it's going to be taken.
Yeah.
People walk away. People walk away from that, and that's huge. I mean, you're ruining the people that enjoy this and do it for the love, not for the money. And then when you do that, you're limiting on who we're going to have left to do this. I mean, if you feel like you can do better, listen, the internet didn't only just give you a voice. The internet gave you a creative platform. So if you think you can do better, stop threatening people. Go do it yourself.
Right?
Yeah.
So this is actually funny. I was cleaning up the office, and I have this sitting here. I've been looking to try to sell it because they've got trades and stuff. But this series has been one of the longest running series. It's called A Distant Soil. I know you can't see us.
Right.
It's called A Distant Soil, and it's by Colleen Duran. And it's an completely independent. I think she's been with Image a few times, and it's like, you know, she's gone on and off different platforms or publishers, but she's been publishing for, oh man, I want to say something in the realm of like 20 years.
Okay. So a long time.
Yeah. And it's just been an ongoing story, but her fan base has grown to such a degree that she's had instances where, like, people have stalked her and I understand the need for that connection. And I think absolutely. Social media has done a huge job. Like, I'm friends on Facebook with Mark Brooks, who's one of my favorite artists. He's done a ton of Marvel stuff. He does a lot of digital stuff, games, card games, just a bunch of different stuff. But he's one of my favorites. And, like, I can chat with him on Facebook at any time. And I don't know, maybe I'm well adjusted enough to be like, that's enough for me. And, like, if I see him at a Comic-Con here and there, that's enough for me. But I just, yeah, you know, that's why you were talking about extremes, you know, you get these people who are just like, I need to be with this person. I need to be in their presence. And it's like, at some point, dude, like, you got to let these people have their space, mm-hmm. you know?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that it's really anybody who's in the public eye and has some kind of thing that people are attached to. So that goes from anybody from that's created books to doing movies and now even YouTube. Like,
yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. You feel connected to that person. Absolutely. And you enjoy what they bring to the table and the entertainment that they provide you with, no matter what platform that's on. But you also got to realize they're human beings as well. And so they, as much as they appreciate you and, you know, obviously are thankful that you enjoy their work and are supporting them, they also do want a little bit of their own time, and you can't just stalk people and stuff like that. If there's a meet and greet, or if there's a show or something like that, or, you know, for instance, I watch obviously a lot of car video stuff, or even Phil DeFranco and stuff like that, they always host like a meet and greet, or, you know, like a show or something where you can see them, you can meet them, you can say what's up. But, like, you got to realize it's saying what's up. It's not like, hey, so we're best friends now. Let's go hang out. Like, it doesn't work that way.
DeFranco was talking about this sometime last week. I think he was talking about something where he was at a grocery store or something, and somebody came up to him and was like, oh, is that Trey? Can I hold him? And I'm like, bro, that's... No, I don't know you.
Yeah,
that's messed up. Like, that's his kid.
Yeah,
that's kind of to, like, that Stephen King novel and movie Misery.
Yeah.
Where, like, people feel like they should have a say in a person's very storytelling. Like, with the Mass Effect thing where Shepard dies at the end. Like, that was their story to tell. And sure. Maybe it didn't make everybody happy that he died, or right. possibly died.
Yeah, I mean, well, I don't know.
They
don't
changed
know
the ending.
Right.
And you know, that was straight out of that movie Misery, which is, you know, if you haven't seen it, definitely watch it.
Right. It's been 35 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I'll definitely. I don't know if I've watched that. It doesn't ring a bell. But...
Where she kidnaps the author.
Or she finds him in a car crash, basically.
Yeah.
And then he's a writer, and she's a huge fan of his work. And, you know, she reads the script that he has in his bag and finds out that he's going to kill off her favorite character.
Right.
And then she makes him basically rewrite the story to make her happy, and, like, she breaks his leg so he can't run away.
Yeah, like, he heals from the car accident, and then he wakes up one morning, and she's, like, busted his knees in and stuff.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, no, but that's, I mean... like getting into that zone where it's like, oh, well, if you don't tell the story the way I want it told, I'm just going to kill you.
Well, here's the thing. That's kind of the problem, right? Because there are people that go to that extreme. And I don't think that's necessarily, you know, that's obviously not the norm. There's a lot of people
sure,
that feel
right.
connected. It's just there's a few of them that, you know, make it hard for anybody to be like, you know, yeah, we're cool, but it can't be. Because there are the people that are, you know, just nice. They want to say, hey, what's going on? How's it going? And, you know, depending who you are, hey, can I take a picture with you, right? Where some people are like that. Not a lot, but enough to right. make people worry that they're out there. So it's, you know, and that's why it's not like these famous people are like, oh, we don't want you to come by or say hi. It's not anything like that, but at the same time, you got to realize where they're coming from, where they have experienced threats and people literally being crazy for them, right? Like, oh, I want to come visit you at home and shit like that, you know? So you can't expect them to always be cool, especially like Philip DeFranco, when you said that, like, he's cool with everybody. He shows his kid on his vlogs, but that doesn't necessarily mean... he will, you know, he can trust anybody to come up to him and be
right?
like oh,
random
is that Trey?
Person
can
walks
I
up.
Can I hold him? Like, that's hard to say yes to, you know?
Right. So. But at the same time, it's hard to say no to because then you don't know how this person is going to react, A.
Absolutely,
and you don't know if
yeah.
you're going to, and you're in a business position where, all right, well, I have these fans. They expect a certain level of access since right. I share, you know, most of my life online. They expect a certain level of access. So it's like, where do I draw the line, and at which point, you know, am I drawing too hard of a line where it's like, am I going to lose people that watch me?
Right.
It's a tough balancing act. Erica was just saying that somebody, one of her friends posted something on Facebook where they're like, oh, I caught Katherine Heigl, like, out, just noticed her somewhere. And she's like, I was going to say something to, you know, I was going to say hi to her. But then I realized that I hate it when random people walk up to me at the grocery store. So I figured she probably does too, and I let her go on about her life as I did with mine. And I was
sure,
like,
of course.
Like, yeah, that's one of those things. Like, that's a cool story to tell. Like, hey, dude, like I saw, you know, like if I saw Will Smith on the street, I'd be like, dude, I was in Chicago, I saw Will Smith on the street. That's fucking crazy. And like, that's the story I have.
Well, yeah, I mean, you have to realize like. Who knows what they're doing right there, right? I
right.
mean, yeah, it's cool that you want to say, hey, how's it going? You know, you want to say, that you respect their work, that you appreciate what they do, but at the same time, like, they could be extremely busy. They could need to go, you know, they're probably, like, in a hurry to go do something. So, you know, it's a tough call when it comes down to stuff like that.
If anything, it should just be kind of like a smile and a wave kind of thing, like...
Yeah, don't run after him. Just be like, hey, you know...
Out at the grocery store with his kid, and it's exactly. Like, oh, can I hold your kid? And it's like... I don't have kids, but I would be a little bit uncomfortable if total stranger,
right.
Absolutely.
Who had only seen me on social media before, came up to me and asked me if they could hold my kid. But
it's, yeah,
some people, they get that disconnect where they're watching the videos and the things that he is saying, they agree with so much that they get this idea that they are connected.
Right.
Because and that's the thing, it's a one-way window. Philip DeFranco doesn't see all of his supporters,
yeah, everybody
or
sees
everybody
him.
That watches his video.
Right,
exactly.
And so they might be getting the impression of this relationship, but he has no idea. He's
right.
Just making his
exactly.
Video because that's what he does.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. Is you, that's another thing that you as a fan have to realize. You might feel connected because they're sharing everything with you, but they don't know you, right? They have no idea who you are, because how do they communicate? How do you communicate with them? You can't, right? I mean, you go to a meet and greet and stuff like that that's available, but
you only get like three to five minutes sometimes.
Exactly.
Right. To exchange information with them. And it's, other than that, it's comments on social media and stuff like that.
Right.
Yeah, it's weird to me to think about, like, how people, they jump into that mode where, to kind of go back with the, you know, letting creators create their stuff, the guy who wrote the new Captain America story, I forget his name, but, you know, he wrote Captain America, and first issue came on, everyone was like, oh my god, Captain America's a Hydra agent, like, I can't believe it, how could you do this? And it's like, and they thought that when the reveal was, oh, it was like somebody basically forcibly changed his history, and they're like, oh, that was us, like, we, you know, the fan outcry made them change the story. Like, no, that's not how stories work. They didn't write it 20 minutes after they published the last
There's
one. They wrote it 6 months ago.
Gonna be some kind of a twist when something like that comes out. It's built to shock,
right?
Of course.
It'd be like, holy shit, you know, Captain America, the most American man in history, is a Hydra agent working for the Nazis.
Right. And that's the thing is, but, like, it goes back. There's an article that was published a while ago. A friend of mine posted it. And it's like, let art be art. Art is to be appreciated, not to be, like, directed. Like, you are not the art director on, you know, whatever, the next Lord of the Rings movie. You're not going to tell them what to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to see what they do with that property. Like, with Ghostbusters. I feel like Ghostbusters is one of those perfect examples for me of fans voting with their wallets. Like, people, you know, the studio wanted to make a new Ghostbusters movie. They created their vision of it. They put it out there. The fans went out. They, you know, they saw it. They didn't like it. No one else went to see it. It lost a bunch of money.
Yeah.
That's how it works. Like,
I did see the movie and I did not enjoy it, but it wasn't for any number of the plethora
of
reasons.
Stupid reasons
that
people
are
like,
know,
oh, it's because women. No, that's dumb.
No, it wasn't that at all. It felt like it was a parody of a Ghostbusters movie, which is what bothered me.
I mean, I think they relied a little too much on the running joke of what's-his-face's character, Thor. I forget his name.
Chris Hemsworth.
Helmsworth being stupid. Like, I felt like they like went back to that a little too much for me. But, like, there's just, like, story points. It was story points. It was the way the film was made. Nothing about the characters, nothing about the actors, as far as, like, how they portrayed them. It was more of, like, how the story was put together. It was a little too corny for me. Even, like, going back and watching the old ones, like, they're corny, but they're, like, 80s corny, and back then it was a humorous horror movie.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this was, like you said, kind of like a parody. Like, let's do this thing where we really just kind of poke fun and what happened before. And even when they had the cameos, when the taxi driver, I can't forget her.
Dan Aykroyd
shows up. Like, his little line, I thought it was hilarious, but only hilarious, like, if they had said that this was a sequel. If they had said that this was a sequel and now you just, like, find them doing random jobs, like, that, you know, the Dan Aykroyd's character is a taxi driver now. And he's like, class 2 apparitions, whatever. I ain't afraid of no ghosts. And I was like, that's a great line. Mm-hmm. But, like, only in context of that he, well, he was a Ghostbuster
before.
Well,
that wasn't Ray Stantz. That was
right.
Taxi Driver A.
Right, and that's the thing is, like, if it had been Ray Stantz, that would have been perfect for me, personally. Like, if they had said, like, this is a thing that happened in the 80s, time moved on, they quit, they moved on with their lives, and now, you know, these people are taking it up again. Mm-hmm. I would, like, I feel like the movie would have even made more sense.
Well, like, I was even considering that, like, Ghostbusters has always dealt with extra-dimensional stuff, even in the first movie.
Sure.
They were battling extra-dimensional beings. And so I was like, oh, well, you know, you could just put it out there that in this dimension,
yeah,
the Ghostbusters are all women.
Yeah.
And, you know, for whatever reason, well, I mean,
I feel like their marketing
it's not like they're going to watch this and be like, hey, that guy's got such a great idea, we're going to run with that.
Let's run with Dan's idea. Who's Dan? Don't worry about it. Just run with the idea.
Just run with that idea. No, I think to me, well, this is a perfect example about, you know, listening to fans and stuff like that. I have no problem with it being an all-female cast. I think the biggest problem that I had with it, one, was they didn't know what they wanted to do, right? At first, they kept saying it's going to be part of the same universe as the originals, and then they were saying it's not, and then ultimately ended up not being it. And I think that was one of the bigger mistakes. I think not making it part of the original universe and trying to make it a remake is what ultimately I think ruined a lot of it, because people were mad that they were trying to ignore the original, and you got to listen to that. If people are not liking that idea, there's got to be a reason that you probably maybe shouldn't go that route.
Yeah.
You can still make the same movie, except just acknowledge the fact that the original Ghostbusters were there, you know, and it's
and
not
it
like
it's
hard.
It would have been easy acknowledge. The guy who was the TV personality.
Peter Venkman.
Yeah, Venkman could have been that guy. Like, that guy could have been Venkman. But it wasn't him. And I'm like, why? Like, it even makes sense for him to have gone on to this career of, like, now you write stories about it, and he's, like, the authority on it. Like, the other two guys retired, and they're doing whatever. But he's the authority, right? So that's why, like, it would have made sense. But they had him be this authority on the subject, even though he wasn't playing that character. And I was like, there were easy, easy ways to make this a connected movie, but you just chose not to do it. And it's annoying in that sometimes, you know, sometimes a sequel is a cash grab. You look at sequels to things like Butterfly Effect, 8mm, was it Carlito's Way? Has a good, like, stupid stuff that should never have had a sequel has sequels. And it's clearly a cash grab. It's just like, X amount of people are going to buy this, and we're expecting this much return on this, like, $1 million investment. Like, we're going to hire nobodies to act these parts, basically recycle the same plot. Here we go, and we're going to get a bunch of money out of it.
Well, yeah, and that's the biggest problem. That's kind of it all depends on. That's why, like, when we're talking about this subject, it ultimately is always going to be what's the driving factor behind it. Because if the driving factor about it is, oh, you know, remakes have been doing pretty decent, let's try this out. Plus, everybody likes Ghostbusters. Who doesn't? Yeah. It's supernatural, right? But that's you can't think that way. And I think a lot of the problems, especially when it comes down to, like, movie stuff, it's not anybody that's involved necessarily with the project, but instead it's the studios, right? They try to, because they own the property, because ultimately they have word what goes and what doesn't.
Sure.
They like to sometimes get involved when they shouldn't.
Fantastic Four.
Fantastic Four, according to Fantastic Four, that's a lot more than just the one entity on that one. But, like, a good example is, not Justice League. Wow, I wish I already watched Justice League.
Right?
No, Suicide Squad. People are saying that Suicide Squad was not what it was supposed to be. There was a lot more Joker that was supposed to be in there that a lot of people believe that would have made this Joker a good Joker if they showed those scenes.
It's not a movie about him, though. Like,
that's
the thing. I felt like it wasn't a movie about him. I felt like he was in there the perfect amount of time as far as, like, his part in the movie and the story.
Right.
I just feel like the way they portrayed him was a disappointment to me. But that's because I had an expectation. Like, I have an image of the Joker in my head.
Yeah, exactly.
I feel like going into, like, the animated series, because I watched that after I watched the original movie. Going into the animated series, thinking about the Joker, I feel like he fit in with the Jack Nicholson Joker. He was just a little more animated. So then when we went to Heath Ledger Joker, it was one of those things where I'm like, wow, he's like way more sadistic, but like I still see it. It's like a creepy laughter and like he's just in there and messing, like, why so serious and all that stuff. Like, it was so well done, but it still to me fit into that whole spiel. I thought when I saw in the comics that he had like peeled his face off and I was like, that's messed up. But like, even that to me was like on the far end of the spectrum, like on the kind of sadistic kind of feel, but like that still to me felt like Joker, whereas this just felt like some sort of gangster that maybe had a fetish for makeup.
Like, yeah, no, that's true though. That's the thing. It that's really what it felt like. I agree. I think ultimately he was in there enough time. I think if he was involved anymore, it wouldn't have been Suicide Squad. It would have been Joker and the Suicide Squad.
Joker and Harley, and then also the Suicide Squad.
Yeah, so like that to me wouldn't make any sense. I think his amount being in there is fine. I think what the biggest problem with it is that, like you said, it's a gangster that likes makeup. That likes to be.
He's like into weird stuff.
There was definitely a lack of Joker-y things in there. Like the, you know, acid lapels and, you know, crap like that.
That's the thing, is I saw Erica, I'm like, I feel like this Joker would never pull a trigger
and have a bang pop out
right.
of
it. I don't think this guy would ever do that.
And I agree. I don't think he would.
It's just not
in his
personality.
Well, that's what's always been so wild about the Joker is that you never really know.
Right.
You could be convinced he's going to kill you.
Right.
And the punchline is that he's not.
Right.
And so, and
like, I feel like when, after watching this Joker, I feel like no doubt that he would kill Batman. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like if it came down to it, he would kill Batman because Batman's in the way. That's, Joker would never kill Batman because Joker wants to mess with Batman. That Joker's existence is for him to with the only person that he wants to mess with is Batman. And yet I feel like this Joker, because the way he was portrayed, I feel like he wouldn't care. If it had to come to it, he'll do it.
I feel like the first chance he got, he would kill him.
Right. Whereas I feel like that's the difference.
I agree.
This is not the Joker that I get that this gangster style Joker was in the comics. Obviously not in the comics that I've read, but regardless, I mean, we've seen gangster style Joker, but at the same time, like, he was still Joker, right? Like, there was a gangster part to him, but not like this. So I don't know. To me, I feel like this is one of those perfect examples where you just kind of gotta, depends who you are and who's involved in the creative aspect of, you know, if it's a movie or a game, and that's kind of how you base off what's do you listen to the fans, do you not listen to the fans, what's too far, what's not, right? Because some people didn't mind Joker, this one. I mean, there's a lot of people that'll easily argue for Joker. For this Joker.
Well, sure. I felt that he was in the movie exactly as much as he needed to be, which was to tell the origins of Harley Quinn.
I agree.
And because the movie is not about the Joker, and, you know, everybody wants to see the Joker played well, and all of that, but his role in this movie was the creator of Harley Quinn.
Right.
Right.
And I think with like Jared Leto, you had those reports probably like first week after the movie came out. They were talking about, oh, Jared Leto pissed off about Joker. And then you read the actual quote and it's like, well, you know what? Like, we filmed these other scenes and I was expecting those to be in it. So, you know, I haven't seen it yet. You know, from what people are telling me, it doesn't sound like these scenes made it in. And it's one of those things like, all right, cool, yeah, but every film has deleted scenes. Every film has stuff that didn't make it on the cutting floor. Yeah, extended cuts, alternate endings, whatever. And we know for a fact that the studio recut this after David Ayer cut it. So it's one of those things that...
I think when the movie comes out for DVD and, you know, Blu-ray...
If they're smart, they'll let him. They'll let Ayer do the same thing that they let Snyder do.
It would be
do.
Like Blade Runner. They'll have an Ayer cut and a director's cut and a final cut and, you know...
Well, here's what I
think. They can choose whichever one that they, you know, really want, you know, to be the story, and, you know, that there you have it.
Well, here's what I just found out. Apparently, David was in part of it towards the end. He left. He left because of creative differences, and they had some other guy finish it up. So,
in directing or
in directing, yeah.
No.
Yeah, he wasn't.
Shit.
He wasn't even part of it towards the end of
no
the
shit.
That's news to me.
Yeah. See, yeah. And, like, I mean, okay, I will say this, that I didn't see a hard cut of difference, right? I didn't see that hard. Where I've seen movies before where, you know, the director changed midway, and you can see, like, one-third of the movie through.
Yeah.
Hard direction different. Change, you know? Like
yeah,
oh, okay.
No, it's apparently he, there was some kind of, obviously, a great amount of disagreement, because from what I can tell, and obviously you can tell when watching the movie, he only had 6 weeks to make the movie. He had 6 weeks to write the movie, the script, the story for this movie.
That's
and then he had to direct it. And then
6 weeks to write it?
Yeah, he had 6 weeks
Get
to write
out
it.
Of here, dude.
And then to obviously create it.
All right, guys, that's... That's my cue. I have to dip out on this
right.
particular podcast.
Gotta go,
it has been...
Gotta go talk to his girlfriend.
Yes. Yes, I do.
All right, bro.
Sounds good.
But it has been great talking with you guys. Hi to the... And bye to the T3G crowd. And
absolutely.
Hopefully, next time, I can stay a little bit longer.
Definitely.
All right, bro.
All right. I'll see you guys later.
Right. See you, man.
Later. So going back to it, yeah, so he...
That's crazy. That's
crazy.
Yeah,
he had 6 weeks. He had 6 weeks to write the story for the movie, which obviously you can definitely... I mean, there was definitely a few things we had issues with, and so you can tell that there was some things that we didn't agree with or that didn't even need to be there. So when I found that out, I was like, well, I mean, that makes sense. And then I guess there was so many... creative differences that ultimately he, towards the end of the movie, decided no. So, and he ended up not finishing the project, and somebody else took over, even though he gets the credit because obviously he did majority of the movie. But yeah, so that's basically
that's
what
crazy.
It ended up being.
I didn't even realize that.
Yeah. So I mean, and that's kind of going back into, you know, what, how much, you know, how much should be, you know, what's too far, what's going too far, and, you know, how much should people listen to, you know, criticism or fans? And I think it just really depends, you know, depends on the situation, because every situation's unique. I think you always should definitely listen to feedback, because... I mean, we always say, especially you always say, if you're not going to, you know, if you're not going to, if you don't want to see something or you're not happy with something, then vote with your wallet.
Yeah.
And so if you know, if you're not, if, or like, for big example is Fantastic Four. There was so much hate behind that movie before it came out.
Yep.
That movie... I mean, I can't even believe that they were even thinking about making another one, even after the bomb.
Hey, according to what is it? I forget the main dude, the guy, the producer. Fantastic Four 2015. Yeah, I guess we'll call it a film.
Right.
At the Razzies, it won Worst Director, Worst Prequel. What? Worst Remake? Worst Prequel, Remake, Ripoff, or Sequel. So it's all one category. Worst and Worst Picture, tied with 50 Shades of Grey. And was also nominated for Worst Screen Combo and Worst Screenplay.
Wow.
Kimberg. Simon Kimberg. Okay. He's still like really dedicated to making a sequel. I heard. It says possible sequel. In November 2015, the sequel was removed from the schedule. Later that month, Toby Kebbell stated he had no interest in reprising his role as Dr. Doom if a sequel were to happen. Obviously not, because Jesus Christ, that was a terrible Doom.
Yeah.
That was awful.
I mean, I don't blame him. The guy, that kid, not kid, he's not old, but he's not a child. But, listen, he's got some acting chops, and I don't blame him for not wanting to be part of something that clearly they weren't going to have any kind of creative control over, because that was awful.
Hey, listen, all I know is she was from Kosovo.
yeah, right? I mean, like, there's just so many. So, yeah, it ultimately, I think it just depends on the case. And I think even for almost any project, if there's been some kind of backing or some kind of previous version of that thing that you're creating, you should probably listen to the fans of it. I'm not saying listen to them 100%, because even that is not going to release a great movie. But at the same time, you should probably listen a little bit, because there's reasons why certain things fail when you don't listen, because you didn't listen at all, you know? And that's the biggest thing. So I think every project should have a little bit of, I think ultimately at the end of the day, like I mentioned, does feedback, you should just have some kind of feedback system and incorporate some kind of feedback system where you hear out what people have to say and then you go from there.
Absolutely. I mean, and that it makes the most sense. Of all things, like with the Windows technical preview or whatever they call it, they have a like an upvoting system in their feedback. So it's like, is this issue or request or whatever something that you want or that you're having with?
How do I sound on your end?
You sound fine.
You sound a little not fine, like you lost like quality. And I'm worried that my...
How about now?
I mean, no. It's definitely a quality thing. It's not how close you are.
I have Edge open.
Edge.
Yeah. You sound surprised.
See what happens.
Whoa. You're surprised by that because no one uses Microsoft Edge.
No, nobody uses it. It's like saying you use Explorer. It's like, you
don't. I can't believe Internet Explorer is still part of the system. It's still in Windows 10.
No, it is. I know.
It's insane.
It's absurd.
So on the... Now to like completely switch topics, since why would I open that? It was just giving me problems. let me end that real quick. On the subject of games, I did, so you know that I've never played MOBAs before, yesterday, 2 days ago, whenever you were here.
Yeah.
And tried out Paragon, and I actually really, really liked it.
Something behind that is gonna be the way it plays. A good amount of MOBAs play click to move and stuff, and most people don't care for that much. So I think because that it uses WASD to move around and then you have your moves, making it more like a MMO, I think makes it more fun. That's why I'm a huge fan of Smite, and as much as I like Blizzard, I'm not the biggest fan of Heroes of the Storm. And also as well, you know, I've dabbled in League of Legends, but I'm not the biggest fan. So I think it just depends on how it plays as a game.
Yeah, I agree. Because I want to say, I don't know if I played. What was the one that League? League is a MOBA, right?
Yeah, League of Legends. Mm-hmm.
I think I tried League for like 3 minutes, and I was like, this is just mind numbing.
I played League for a while.
It was just not like interactive enough. It was just like point and watch, point and watch.
You know? Right. I mean, you definitely had to do a little more than just watch. But to get somewhere, yes, you would point and then pay attention that nobody ganks you while you're running there. But I mean, yeah, you're right. I mean, I've never been a fan of point and click. That's why it's been hard for me to get into Diablo. I play it here and there, but it's really hard for me to get serious about it because it's always been a point and click. And I used to like it back in the day. Back in the day, in Diablo 2 days, yeah, I enjoyed it. But I don't know. Recently, after getting accustomed to MMO games and stuff like that, I just prefer not to click to move. So it's, you know, obviously I'm not the people that those games are appealing to, and that's fine. I'm just happy to see companies like Epic and is it Sierra that make MOBAs that use the style that I at least there's somebody out there that is looking to, you know, go for Smite, people like myself.
Smite is supposed to be, oh bloody hell, I keep clicking the wrong stuff. Smite is it Sierra or
Smite? I mean, it's whoever makes Tribes.
Well, Tribes used to be Sierra.
Right.
Smite is made by Hi-Rez.
Hi-Rez, that's right.
Hi-Rez is the company that bought out Sierra or whatever, bought out the license for Tribes.
But yeah, so yeah, no, but it did look like a fun game. Nice. I love the graphics on it. I think graphically it's amazing.
Her sight is really nice.
Who, Smite?
Yeah.
Or Hi-Rez?
Sight is really nice, man. I'm.
I mean, yeah, they use tournament. They have money. So I'm assuming they're going to make it pretty decent because they host tournaments and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's like one of my you know rabbit holes that I end up falling into, and I'm like, oh, this site is really cool. So then I'll like dig into the code and figure out what they're using, and I'm like, right. Man, like I just like to see how people do great stuff. And the same way I like to, like, if I get to a site that's so bad and I'm just like, How do you make a site this bad? And then I got to do the same thing. I got to open up the code, like inspect stuff. And I'm like, what are they building it with? You know, like how do you screw up a site this bad? Right. Especially when it's like with one of those, like Wix, which like is like drag and drop stuff. And it still looks like ass. So like so basically all the graphics you're using are ass and like you're not paying attention to any of the layout. So it's like, yeah, I understand that it's a do-it-yourself thing, but just let somebody else do it.
Oh, for sure. Absolutely.
Like, at least have somebody take a look that's, like, not a friend. So I feel like these people's friends are looking at it. They're like, yeah, bud, it's great. It's great, bro. It's great. You're going to do great.
Yeah. But going back into criticism and, you know, how much should be taken, how much you should listen to it, like, I think one of the another great examples that we can go to is, I think, that example. I think Assassin's Creed is going to be a good movie. I don't think it's going to be, I mean, listen, to me, it's going to be a great movie. Is it going to be a great movie to others? Probably not, but I think people are still going to enjoy it. But I think the reason for that is because Michael Fassbender, one, was not going to do the movie unless the director and the studio understood what he wanted creatively out of that, right?
Right.
And because he's really a big, from what I understand, a pretty big fan of the game and of the story, that either it was going to be done right or he didn't want to do it at all. And so, and I think from what we're seeing in the trailer, it looks like it's going to be a good movie. Now,
it looks
good,
great. It looks great, yeah, man.
I mean, I'm excited about it. I mean, I'm truly excited about it.
Do you think it looks better than Warcraft looked from its trailers?
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. I thought Warcraft looked cool. I was excited for Warcraft. I'm glad I saw it in theaters. I think it was good. I think it was a good movie.
I'm definitely buying the Blu-ray.
I think Assassin's Creed feels like a movie that is going to appeal to a broader audience.
For sure. Absolutely. I agree with that.
I feel like it's gonna do better at the box office, but they better ramp up their marketing hardcore in the next.
Because aren't they open up against a few not-so-good things? Because that was the movie we said. The week
their opening is fine, but like the week before and the week after they're
is
dead.
Not.
They're
right.
dead. So they definitely, because I think Rogue One opens like the week after.
Yeah, and that's just,
and it's like you gotta make like you have 7 days to make money.
Yeah,
like if you don't make your budget in 7 days, game over.
Absolutely, 100%. I mean, you're talking about Rogue One. You're talking about Star Wars fans. That's definitely the same fans that would see Assassin's Creed. It's the same type of group, you know. Yep.
And Star Wars fans, diehards, are going to see Rogue One two or three times before they'll go see Assassin's Creed.
Oh, for sure. Absolutely.
So you better get them to see it that week. You better talk about that sci-fi aspect of it.
You better grab their attention somehow.
I think the first trailer was great, though. I think the first trailer was on point.
Oh, absolutely. I 100% agree.
I think the only thing that was missing on like a broad level, the only thing that was missing from Warcraft to me was like some, just like a hair better graphics, in some scenes, but otherwise I think it was, you had some young people. I mean, you had some young people, some people who hadn't done movies before or hadn't done big movies before. And I think the marketing wasn't that great. I think they didn't play to the right audiences. I think they were trying
for I'm sorry, were we talking about World of Warcraft here?
For the Warcraft movie.
Yeah, I agree with you.
I feel like the marketing wasn't targeted well enough. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like they didn't. It was one of those things. I think they were trying to get everyone, and because they were trying to get everyone, they didn't get their core audience.
Right.
At least not all of it. I mean, I'm sure they got some of them just by people knowing that there was a movie coming out.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's the same thing. Like, I saw something from the trailer for the new King Arthur movie, just like a quick snippet, and it looked freaking amazing. It looked outstanding. The new King Arthur movie.
Oh yeah, it looks good.
I saw just like the briefest like. They were like running through some stuff, and I was like, "What is this?"
There is a trailer for it.
Arthur trailer.
No, it looks like a movie.
Does it say that I watched it? I definitely did not watch this. Me. Oh, because I started playing it. You know what? I started playing it when we were talking, and as well as at work, and the computer crashed that I was on. So I forgot to open it back up. Because I remember this opening, because I remember muting it and pausing it because we were talking. Because I linked to it. I hadn't watched it yet. But I'm not going to play it on the podcast.
Yeah, let's not play it on the podcast.
But I'll leave this open so that I can remember.
But it does, in my opinion, it does look like a good movie.
It looks cool. I like the people that are in it, so I'm pretty excited.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm absolutely excited. I can't wait.
Charlie Hunnam.
I mean, listen, my Sons of Anarchy, man. He you know, at first it took me a long time to get used to that show, but after watching him, I just want to see him in more stuff. I want to. He did that role good. So,
I feel like I could play this as long as I react. I mean, like we're recording, so I could react to it. It's my reaction.
I mean, you could, yeah.
I don't want to
blast people's ears just in case.
That's fair. Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
And I want to listen to it at full tilt, so.
Exactly.
I'll wait till tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll wait for tomorrow and we'll talk about it on the next one.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, everything ultimately, like for instance, I think the Rose in Warcraft didn't do great, but did good. And I think the biggest reason for that is because the director played World of Warcraft. He was a fan. He wasn't just a guy that wanted to direct the movie.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
And I think that
That comes worked. Into play, man. That comes into play. You can't ignore the connection to the source material.
Right.
You look at something like Kevin Smith. Kevin Smith, I think, in my opinion, makes consistently good movies when he's making his movies.
Yeah.
I haven't seen Tusk. I've heard Tusk is kind of weird.
It's weird, but I don't think... here's the thing. It's weird, and if you can't accept weird, then you're not going to like the movie. But I think it's still a good movie. Like, I think it's
and I
still...
Hear, and I hear Jersey... I mean, even he admits that Jersey Girl is kind of a joke.
I don't know if I've ever watched Jersey Girl.
I haven't either, but I know he's made mention of it. But he's like... You know, he directed an episode of Flash. He's going to direct an episode of Supergirl.
Yeah, of course.
And like... To me, it's one of those things like when you're connected to the source material, like the way, you know, like the way he is. He's a nerd. He's a huge nerd. So like him directing, I've never ever been concerned if he was to say tomorrow that he's going to direct Batman, I'd be like, okay,
yeah.
I'd be like it's Kevin Smith. I know he's a good director. I know he has a connection to the content, to the material.
Oh, for sure.
They could say he'll direct any movie in the cinematic universes, the comic book cinematic universes. I'll be like, cool, because I know this guy will do the research. I know this guy will. I mean, like, just seeing him talk about the script that was demanded of him for Superman Lives, you know, he's right. Like, he wanted a fucking giant spider. Like, I don't know what the fuck this guy was on. And it's like, you see, like, he knows what he should be writing, but this guy's asking for a giant fucking spider, you know? Like,
yeah. No, absolutely. I mean, there's certain people that know what they want and how to do it, and usually they go. Here's the thing: so, there's a lot of people out there that, you know, I'll watch online and I'll stop watching their movie because they'll say something along the lines like, "Oh, you know, the reason they should start getting new directors because DC is finally realizing that that what's his name,
Zack Snyder."
Zack Snyder doesn't know how to make comic book movies. And I'm like, excuse me? You're talking about a nerd.
Nope.
A nerd.
That's not true. Because Watchmen was probably one of the most faithful representations of comic book to film.
Absolutely.
Ever.
And there's nothing... I mean, listen, you might
Except
have
maybe
your...
Iron Man was pretty dumb.
You might have your issues with Superman, but it's not a bad movie. And he's not looking to make that movie bad. He's just doing a story... In his own
his
way.
Version. That's the thing. That's the thing that really bothers me, man. When you have these people who just will start complaining, like you know, my buddy Doc, he talks about he has Superman on this pedestal. He's a huge, huge fan of Superman, and I understand that. Like, you have a certain view of this character, and
sure.
You expect representations of him to reflect this character.
Absolutely.
And but to me, like, I've read so many different Superman stories, everything from, you know, alternate universes, alternate timelines, history, whatever. And to me, Superman is the pinnacle, the ideal. And nothing, nowhere says that you can't have him be. Like, I think the Grounded story is kind of like the reverse of what happened in Man of Steel. That Grounded two-volume story was absolutely fantastic. Had Superman be like, listen, I feel like I'm disconnected from these people. I'm just going to walk America. I'm just going to walk across America and deal with the stuff I see right then and there.
Well, one of the things that I brought up to you when we were having our conversation about Man of Steel and how... you know, Superman, you know, always saves people. He doesn't back off. He doesn't. Then we got into a conversation because I, you know, I recently read up Infinite Crisis. And then right after that, I read the other two books of Superman that came out after that. And in those books, in one of them, he says, I think the power didn't originally return to me because I didn't want it to. So to say that, like, Superman is always going to do the right thing, I think is inaccurate. I think he is just like anybody else, that he has to learn what the right thing is, right? He knows what right things are, but I think just like anyone, he's going to feel anger and he's going to feel a specific a passion for certain things in a different way. So you can't say, oh, because he is literally God, that he's always going to make the right decision, because right. I don't think that's accurate. I don't think that's possible.
He still has human frailties and human sensibilities. Yeah, and absolutely. He can falter, and that's fine. And that's the thing, is that people see, like, the overall vision of Superman. Like, overall, if you were to say the entirety of Superman's career since 1939, yes, absolutely. Yeah. Superman does the right thing.
He will most likely try to do the right thing. Absolutely.
That's absolutely. You can say that and be right 99.99% of the time.
Exactly.
But there are situations where he doesn't do the right thing. He does the wrong thing for the right reason. So I didn't read the actual story. I don't know if he actually ever went up against the Elite, but in the movie, Superman versus the Elite, he did that incredible, incredible stage show.
Yeah.
Where he, like, tossed these guys around and made them, like, basically made it look like he killed them.
Yeah.
Just to prove a point to this dude. And then, by the way, no one mentions this. Then he lobotomized the guy without permission and without any jurisdiction.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's a perfect example right there. So for anybody to say, oh, you know, Superman doesn't do stuff like, I think you just read specific stories of Superman and you don't recognize the other things that he's done.
Yeah, you may have read the stories where he does the right thing every time, but there are the stories in between all those stories where there's one issue or there's, you know, whatever series of events cause him to make a mistake. I mean, let's be serious. The fight with Doomsday probably killed a lot of people.
Absolutely.
They fought across, like, half the country.
Yeah. Yeah, in the actual, the comic, they destroyed each other.
Like, and it's one of those things, people are like, oh, like he killed so many people in Metropolis in the movie. Yeah, it's happened before. Right. When he fought a Kryptonian on Earth. It's hard to keep that, like, you can't really keep that collateral damage.
No, I completely agree, man. I think if you're expecting the Superman that everybody knows right away,
I feel like it would probably be corny.
Yeah, it would be corny.
It'd be corny, like the perfect dude who always does the right thing every time. It'd be corny, and I think people would not receive it well. And I think you could even look at Superman Returns as kind of an example of that. He came through. He was perfect. Like, the stuff that they focused on with his abilities was, like, he saves a plane and he takes a bullet to the eye, and it's like nothing can harm him, and he's doing the right thing every time, and he sacrifices himself to throw a giant block of kryptonite off the world just to pass out, not die like he should have.
Yeah, no, that's the thing. Like, that, and you're absolutely right. It's I think right there is a perfect example how this is a better storytelling, because it and where's the fun in that, right? Like, that doesn't fit, in my opinion. And then everybody's like, oh, but it should be like Marvel. No, it shouldn't be like Marvel, because if it was like Marvel, then where would be the difference? Where would be the uniqueness to it? When would, like, I'm watching them the same movie, and that would be awful.
Here's the thing. What's funny is that it's actually kind of the reverse is happening now in the cinematic universes that was happening in the comics in the 90s, for me at least.
Right.
The way I saw, like, in the 90s, Marvel was, like, pulling triggers on just, like, universe-changing stuff, right? So you had Tony Stark turns out to be a bad guy from the beginning. like the beginning. Since the first time they face Kang, Tony Stark turns out to be a bad guy. What happens? He sacrifices himself and he's replaced by like an 18-year-old version from an alternate timeline. So now this 18-year-old Tony Stark or 17-year-old Tony Stark is like running a multinational company. He is hitting on his best friend's girlfriend or wife. He hits on Pepper, and Pepper's married to Happy Hogan at that time frame. And then they're like, you know what? All these things that we just did, and like Joseph, which was the replacement of Magneto, because like, oh, Magneto lost his memory, and now he's part of the X-Men. And so then like, oh, that all that? Now, Onslaught devastates everyone, kills off the main heroes. And now in the Marvel Universe proper, you just have the X-Men and just like sprinkles here and there. And then they're like, oh, well, now we're going to throw in these bad guys who are pretending to be good. So you just had all this crazy, crazy stuff happening that like really hadn't been done on the scale they were doing it. Like in 97, which was the year when they did the alternate reality with Heroes Reborn, and they did the Thunderbolt showed up and all this stuff happened. 97 was a rough year for everybody. Like the X-Men were in pieces. Their mansion was taken apart. They were living like out of, like they had like mattresses on the floor with nothing else in the room. You know what I'm saying? Like they had nothing.
Right, I got you.
And it's like the status quo changed so hard. Whereas on the DC side, everything was just like chugging along. Like the Justice League series was going strong. The Superman books were going strong. Like just kind of like regular things. Like nothing crazy really happened in the 90s in the like core DC books. You had good stories. Like the JLA series had good stories. Like some really great stories. But it was just kind of like, bad thing is happening. Let us all rally together and win. Yay. One of the greatest stories in the JLA series is called World War III. It's one of my favorite volumes to read. And it's this huge thing where it's basically like the like before gods, this thing called Mageddon. It was the thing that killed the gods.
Right.
It's like this doom weapon of beyond doom weapons. It was coming to Earth. And like for the first like 30 issues or whatever, somebody shows up and they're like, Mageddon is coming. Oh, now I can't give you any more information. You know, it's like, by the way, like this thing's going to kill you all. Oh, I'm dead. Or like, teleported to another dimension. So like little bits of information and then it shows up and they're like fighting it. And Superman is like, Superman does the unthinkable. So he realizes that, well, if I can absorb light, why can't I absorb anti-light?
Right.
So then he absorbs this thing's core, which is just darkness.
Right.
And I'm like, I'm sorry, did you just will yourself to like do the exact reverse pot? And that's what I'm saying. Like Superman was perfect. He fought an angel because the angel was wrong and Superman fought him. Because that's what Superman does. You know what I'm saying? Like, you had these huge, enormous stories, but at the same time, like at the end of that, it was like mankind came together to fight this thing while Superman figured out that he could beat him his own worst fears and imperfections inside of himself, and then to absorb the sun, the like anti-sun inside of this thing.
Right.
And then come out and be like, the apocalypse has been averted. And I was like, damn, like that's badass, right? But It wasn't story stuff. It wasn't like, I feel like it wasn't characterization. You know what I'm saying? It was just like Superman did this awesome Superman thing. And like, that's what I'm saying. Like when Man of Steel ended and we were at that point where he's holding him and he's holding his head and he's about to kill that family. And I'm sitting there and all I could think was, what is the Superman solution to this? Right. I'm like, how does Superman get out of this? And when he popped his neck, I was like, but then I was like, it makes sense. Like that's you had no other option.
What option did you have at that time?
And it was one of those things where I'm like, I understand why this was necessary, because any of the fixes I was thinking in my head, like freeze ray or whatever, freeze breath, and anything I was thinking of would have been super corny.
Oh my, huge!
Any dude, Superman solution would have just been dumb.
If they
corny.
Did something like fucking freeze breath, I would have been hugely disappointed.
And
hugely.
And it was one of those things like, and I resolved it in my head. I'm like, I know that Superman in the past killed Zod and Zod's followers by with kryptonite. He killed them with kryptonite.
I mean, if you think it's any better that he sends them out into the fucking
the Phantom Zone.
Hey,
let me just put you guys away for the rest of eternity.
For the rest of eternity, and literally what you think is hell. Yeah.
Yeah. If you believe Smallville.
Yeah. Then he's doing a great job, right? You know.
It's. I think they. And that's what I'm saying is now in Marvel, all the heroes in like the Marvel Cinematic Universe, for the most part, I won't say that the mixed feelings of Civil War didn't happen, but I feel like overall, the good guys win by doing some good guy shit.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. It's the flip side of what happened in the 90s in the comics. Like at Marvel, it was like dumb, crazy shit. Like just, let's just try stuff out and like go into characterization and Rogue for like a 3-month period or a 5-month period is going to try to cure her illness or, her powers rather. So she can touch people again because she feels awful for stranding Gambit in the middle of nowhere. And there's just the like really, really character driven stories. Whereas on the DC side, it was just like superhero stuff. And now it's like in the movies, it's the opposite. In the DC movies, it's like characters and like deep exploration of character motivations and stuff. Whereas on the Marvel side, it's like superhero stuff. like we win.
Yeah,
and it's not bad. I'm not saying the Marvel stuff is bad. I just think it's a different approach. And if they were to for some reason, let's say, go in and say, oh, we're gonna do the super dark thing, I don't think it would work. I'm really interested to see how they plug in what I feel is a dark character, Ghost Rider, into the Agents show. Agents, to me, it is a character-driven show, I will say. But at some point, it's kind of like a good guy versus bad guy show. Like, you have a bad guy, and then you have the good guys. And that's kind of the show. So to bring in this dude who is all about, like, punishing, like, legit punishing evildoers, on a flaming motorcycle with a skull and the flaming skull for a head. I feel like he's going to be a very expensive character, and I feel like he's going to show up twice in the whole season, and then we're just going to have either Danny Ketch or Johnny Blaze just chilling and hanging out and shooting the shotgun with the Hellfire bullets.
Right.
Yeah, I feel like we're going to get like two, if we get four like straight up like scenes or episodes with Ghost Rider proper, I'll be surprised.
Oh yeah, for sure. I'll be
genuinely surprised if we get four solid episodes with Ghost Rider, because I feel like it's way too expensive for character. You look at what's his face, Firestorm. Even Firestorm on a show where they already have him built, like the CG is already developed in multiple like angles and actions and everything. You could replay half the shit you could replay and just like play the one from the third episode in episode 17 and just like play it from a different angle. Cool. We didn't have to do anything. Whereas like this is a brand, like, and even then they use him sporadically. Like they use the characters more than anything. Whereas this is a character that we haven't even seen before. So, like they have to build him. They have to build that CG and then execute it properly and then do it more than once. And I just think we're going to get a lot of Danny Ketch or Johnny Blaze and just a lot of it. I think
you're 100% correct, because I mean, when they announced, when they said, hey, we're doing Ghost Rider on,
I've never, let me tell you this.
I lost train of thought. I'm like, what do you mean you're doing Ghost Rider on Agents?
I've like, never been what? Less excited for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. than I am now.
Because, I mean, it doesn't make sense.
Like, I've never been less excited. It's
why in the world would you do... Why in the world would you do that on Agents when you can already tell that they have issues doing...
A lot of CG and stuff
like that. A lot of CG and stuff like that. So like why
and would you... this is on ABC prime time, This guy shows people the worst, all the evil things they've done into their brain.
That's literally what I was just going to say. I'm like, this man shows you some dark stuff.
It's like, oh, the pain of every person you have ever hurt into your mind at the same time.
Have a good day. I think it definitely should have been a Netflix show. I don't know their thought process. I can't even assume their thought process.
If they had done the season, you know, like the... As soon as, let's say, Defenders, or maybe like once Cage was done.
Right.
As soon as, like, you know, you had two left, you had Iron Fist and Defenders left. Mm-hmm. And if they were like, hey, round three, guess what, guys? Ghost Rider. Guess what, guys? Daredevil season three, Jessica Jones season two. And I was like, I would have been in forever.
Yeah.
Dude, you could have raised the price of Netflix to $20 a month. I would have been in.
I mean, I don't. Now you're getting a little ridiculous.
I'm just saying it's going to happen eventually. I'm just saying I would have accepted it because I would have wanted to see it.
I hope you're wrong. I hope it doesn't happen eventually because that's
I mean, insane. Like, eventually it will. Like, within 10 years.
In 10... Because right now it's $10. No. For streaming only? No. No, man. No way. $20? That's absurd.
I mean, they might... But, like, it might depend on whether they might have more content, different content, and they might have other options. I don't know. I'm just saying the possibility is there, and I am here on the internet saying that if the right content and the right media is available to me on demand at any time... Yeah, right. 20 is acceptable to me. If you gank that license for Runaways off of Hulu, yeah, then I don't have to pay for Hulu.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the thing that bothers me is that now I have to pay for Hulu because I gotta watch Runaways. That's one of my favorite. Actually, I wish Dan was still here. That's one of Dan. That's probably Dan's favorite comic series besides Punisher.
Runaways.
It's the long. The short pitch is a bunch of kids, at like a sleepover, basically realize that their parents, who were all there, are part of this cabal of evil of like villains. They're all villains. They're like planning to take over and destroy the world or whatever. Like, they figure that out and they're like, "Fuck these guys! We are definitely gonna go and run this shit on our own and stop them." So, and they're just like these kids who are the kids of villains, and they either have powers or they're smart or whatever. And like the one chick has a dinosaur. She steals a dinosaur. The one chick is an alien, alien mutant, actually. It's just like, it's cool. I like the series. They're like mainstays of the Marvel Universe that don't always play into everything. But they always show you like the impact on them. So right. Like when Secret Invasion happened, they showed they had a Runaways book with it was Runaways and what's the other one? Young Avengers. It was the kind of a combo book between the two of them and like how the invasion affected them and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Same thing with Civil War. Same thing with the Initiative and all that stuff. So I just thought it was. A cool thing that they got that. I think it's a good story. You're going to have me... I don't want to say that it's easy to cast, but you just get a bunch of, like, attractive young kids to play, you know, some 15, 16, 17-year-olds.
You mean CW?
That's what I'm saying. I feel like this is a CW show just on Hulu about Marvel characters. This was a CW comic before CW existed.
Right.
I'm telling you, man, that's one of the easiest channels to peg. I was at my mom's house once, and I turned around, and on the TV, I don't know what's playing. On the TV, I just see, like, 15, like, 19 to 27-year-olds, and they're all attractive. Like, all of them. And I'm like, must be the CW. And then it goes into commercial, the 100, we'll be right back. And I was like, no, the CW.
I mean, the 100, I love that show.
It's a good show. I am a season behind. It's too bad. I am a season behind. What's too bad?
Oh, I'm sorry, the 100. I was thinking something else. I was thinking tomorrow, people.
I was like, the 100 isn't getting canceled, no.
Yeah. No, no,
the one chick left because she got a new job.
Yeah, and that goes back to what this whole thing started about.
Yes, was, people complaining, and they're like, oh. People
complaining, oh, they killed off because it was because of...
She got another job, and she was only going to be able to do like two more episodes.
But her character was, what was it? She was lesbian or something?
She was lesbian on the show, yeah.
Yeah, and they were like, oh, this is, you know...
Yeah, the whole thing about, against LGBT or whatever.
Yeah, and I'm like, she got
another job, and she told them, guys, I can only do like 3 more episodes, and then I got to go. I'm going to go film for AMC for Fear of the Walking Dead and get paid just fat buckets of money.
I'm saying, and I'm like, how can you even be mad at that? She got another job.
It bugs me when they say when people say shit like that. It's like, oh, they're being like this group or this type of character or whatever is being targeted, and like, no, like, understand the situation. Right. They were like, here's what's gonna happen. She's going to leave regardless.
Yeah.
So either we make her character just like not important anymore, which would be very difficult since she's like the main character's girlfriend.
I'm saying.
Or we kill her to drive forward the other aspects of the story, aspects that people were already saying were kind of thin and have now been empowered by this situation.
Absolutely.
Yeah, let's do that and make the story better and make the show better than just losing a character for no reason.
That goes back into the whole, like, the personal aspect of, you know, what people see and stuff like that, like how deep they get connected to it and stuff like that, because ultimately, like, you got to realize, like, there it's not always a witch hunt. Like, I know that what,
like, it's not 1955. They didn't find out she was gay, and then they're like, whoa, gotta go,
can't have that. No, you gotta, it was nothing like that. They just
listen. No, it's 2016. She got offered fat loads of money from AMC, and CW was like, "Nah, we don't want to pay you that much."
Yeah.
Or she was like, "Listen, guys, like, it's gonna pay the same." Yeah, she's like, "It's gonna pay the same, but it's cable. It's the Fear of the Walking Dead. Like, 10 million more people are gonna watch me. It's gonna open up more doors for me. I gotta go."
Well,
and the CW was like, "Cool, we got it."
Yeah. Like, how do you complain about that? You know, how do you? Like, how do you argue against that? You know, person's trying to better themselves.
It's just one of those things. Like, here's the thing. We are, to go back to the original subject of, you know, character, people complaining about video games. We have a video game, right?
Yeah.
You know, G-Shift, it's on Steam. We have mostly negative reviews.
Yeah.
That is what it is. We are currently not in a position to address the issues that are being discussed. So they are, you know, the people's complaints are certain control mechanics. The people are complaining about...
Did you lose train of thought?
No, there's movement above me.
Oh.
But no, people are complaining about certain control mechanics, about the jump speed, and just like certain little things that I feel like could be addressed very easily. I am currently in the process of learning Unity and learning how to code within Unity and how to edit. Right. You know, my goal is to then be able to go in and edit the game code, or, I mean, fuck it, if need be, go into a new game, follow it up.
Absolutely.
Follow it up, fix the things that were wrong with it before. You know, we're going to drop the price. I still think it's a fun game. I think it's an enjoyable game. But it's one of those things, like, most of the people who have taken the time to review it, and mind you, we've had, I can't even tell you, we've had several thousand activations.
Right.
Then we've got, like, 15 reviews. So, like,
right.
I think there's a few hundred players, like people who have actually played it, as far as the stats go. You know, out of 300 people that have played it, 14 or 15 or whatever people have taken the time to review it. Are the other 385 people cool with it? You know what I'm saying? Like,
Yeah.
They're just like, it's a good game. It's not a bad game. It's not an awful game. It's not a great game. I'm not going to review it. It's kind of, I feel like it's one of those situations like with certain apps. Like, you know how apps will, on your phone, will be like, oh, will you take the time to rate this app?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm kind of with Mike Falzone on this. He's like, Instagram doesn't need me. They don't need my review.
Right.
They're saying Instagram is doing its job. And when Instagram doesn't do its job, I'm going to have things to say about it. Right. Same thing with Facebook. Facebook is doing its job. When it doesn't, I send them feedback.
Right.
That's how it is. And to me, I feel like that would be better than, you know, I feel like, you know, to me, I still look at it as a positive. Yeah, we have mostly negative reviews, but that's the people who have taken the time to review it. You know, we have 375 or 385 other players who seem to like it. Yeah. Just fine.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know,
it's not great. It's not awful. It's just fine. And it's funny, when it first came out, that's kind of like the reviews we were getting. The reviews
like, this could be better, but not bad.
It was kind of like, the game is good. It's not great. It's not horrible. And I was mad. I was like, either hate it or love it. Don't give me this,
you weren't liking that, but I was perfectly fine.
And I'm like, I was really, really mad about it, because I'm like, how many games do you buy?
Right.
You know, how many games that are good? Like, not great, but good. you don't, you know, unless there's something unique about it. And that's kind of where I was then. But now I'm like, yeah, that's fine. But like, a bunch of people have bought it through bundles. A bunch of people play it. And I feel like if we were to go in and say, hey, G-Shift 2, here's a demo. Check it out. We fixed all the stuff you guys are complaining about.
Right. I mean, that's the thing. It's all about what's your opportunity to fix it, you know? Unfortunately, we don't have the means to fix the issues that are being
expressed. Yeah, the coder that originally worked on the game is in college currently. He is like, eyeballs deep in code. So to be like, hey, bro, can you edit some of this code for me?
Right.
Maybe kind of an asshole thing to do at this point.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and even if he said yes, you know, if he needed the money, we might not be able to afford that at the current moment. Right. You know? So
he's way more expensive now than he used to be. You know what I'm saying?
Like, oh, yeah, for sure.
He was 16 when he wrote this code, and he learned code as he went. So it's one of those things, like, it's – and he even said, I was like, dude, how can we port this? Can we export to mobile? He's like – and this was, what, 2011? Right. And he's like, yeah, I could, but no phone would be able to run it. He's like, the code is a mess. He's like, you got to understand, like, the stuff that I knew at the end of the game, I didn't know at the beginning. So, like, all the like, everything that makes the code clean towards the end, it makes it ugly at the beginning because I didn't know any of it. And I was like, that's fair. But now I'm like, everything's quad core, 8-core, or 16-core, or whatever the hell phones are now. And I feel like now if we were to export it to mobile, it would work.
I mean, it absolutely would work, but that's the thing. But then it's all about, you know, either us learning code or getting somebody that has code, which neither one's easy. To learn code is not easy, and to get somebody that knows code.
It's time-consuming. That's the thing. For me, code is something that I take to. It comes pretty easily to me, but when I have the time. Like, when I sat down with that class that I'm taking for it, and I sat down with it for a night, I made the first game.
Right.
Because it was just like, oh, cool, this makes perfect sense, boom, boom, and I'm going to expand on it, I'm going to add stuff to it, boom, like, I'm already working it. But, like, I'm going to need several more just days of that.
Right.
And having everything else on my plate, too, it's difficult to get that going. That's why I was trying to do this thing with the 100 days. It hasn't been the greatest. It hasn't worked the greatest. But I'm gonna try to get that done. So here's the thing. The current vlog, which is like 2 weeks behind, the current vlog is going to be from last week. Like, the next one that's gonna go up is from last week. The following one after that is gonna be hella long. Because it's going to be like the entire 2 weeks between the last time I recorded and the time I finished the recording. Because I still haven't done the work that I said I was going to do at the end of the last one.
Right.
But I've also come up with other stuff because Mike finished his run. My friend Mike who did the 100. That's like how when I was watching his, kind of how I got into it. Sure. He finished his run and was basically just kind of focusing on getting his comic done and getting it published through the one site. And then he said, I'm going to go back in and I'm going to work on this again. I'm going to work on it under, you know, a timetable. And I don't know if I inspired him or what, but he's also using the 100 days to incorporate some of the other stuff he's got going on. So he's adding his workouts in. He's adding his business stuff in, trying to figure out how to, like, sell his artwork and stuff like that. So I think he's... You know, I hope I inspired him in that way, and that, you know, adding those other segments, and I hope it helps him and gets that stuff done for him. But it's one of those things, like, he's now on like day four of his second run. The other guy, Gaz, that's on the 100 is on day like 40 something of the second run, and I'm like, fuck, I feel like Gaz wasn't done when I recorded the last blog that was daily. I'm like, has it been that long since I recorded?
Yes, it has.
So yeah, I just got to get that done. You know what it was, and I went over this in the vlog. I felt like now that like the creative portion was done, there just wasn't much to talk about. It was like, okay, so like, you know, I had a few back and forths with the artist. I looked at some colorists online. Like, I just didn't have much to say. But then, you know, Mike was talking about this is where I was going with the Mike thing. Mike was talking about in his, like, you know, he's doing the business stuff. He's talking about how to do the prints, how to set up the graphics for his videos and all the stuff. And I'm thinking, like, yeah, like there are other aspects of Wolfpack that still need to get done. I'm right. Making the Facebook page. It's gonna be on the Catalyst site, so I gotta make the Catalyst site. Well, there's really no way around that one. Like, right. I need that site to be there. Absolutely. So those are all things that I can work on, and it kind of got me back in that mentality of like, I still have creative things to work on within this project.
Yeah.
You know, I wish I could draw. I wish we had an artist that was already on board.
Right.
But you know, it is what it is. I saw an artist today at the con that I went to. I don't know if you saw on the calendar, I went to a Lake County con. It's going to be a separate video I filmed.
Really cool stuff. Did you go?
Yeah. 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 Cause we were up there for Fort to Base for Erica. She ran a three.
Was that the thing you invited me to?
Maybe.
I mean, you sent me an invite like during the week, and I couldn't go because it was on a Sunday. It was in Rockford or Juliet, should I say?
Juliet.
It was the Rockford Comic Con, so.
Oh, Love's Park, yeah.
Love's Park, my bad.
Oh, so Insane Comics was there, right? And Insane Comics is from Rockford, and. I was like, hey, are you guys going to the Rockford con? And he's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, oh shit, like you didn't know. So I pointed to him. I'm like, it's not in Rockford, it's in Love's Park. He's like, I live in Love's Park. And I show him the Facebook page. He's like, that's 400 feet from my house. I'm like, how did you not know about it?
I mean, so I've seen people not notice a lot of things that's happening around them. That's why, you know, I have a lot of people that approach me for like, oh, how do you know about car events? I look like it's not just easy to find it. I mean, you have to take a moment to just, you know, look what's available and find it. Like I know Facebook is huge. People like to post things on Facebook. So let's see if there's any events going on, and I find it and there it is.
Right. All right. Exactly. Well, it's one of those things I hadn't thought about, like, just flat out looking, so I just hadn't. And it was one of those things where, like, I knew there was a Rockford con, and that was earlier this year. So
I would have never guessed that Rockford had something like that.
Dude, if Gray's Lake's got a con, let me tell you, the building we were in was built within the last year or two.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, like, at least two, because they had it there last year too, apparently. And, like, that's the thing, this con happened last year, and I didn't know about it.
Oh, wow. Yeah, no.
Yeah, so, like, I never heard about it. No one ever said anything about it. Jason, the guy from the comic shop, Jason asked me on Facebook. He's like, hey, how was the show? I'm like, good. And, like, it's from the people I talked to. Like, I talked to Insane. I talked to our buddies at One Round were there.
Okay.
Yeah, so they everybody said that they were making money. So I was like, hey, people are making money. So maybe next year you go.
Yeah.
Because they had a few vendors, but like it really felt more of like a varied thing. It wasn't just like the Milwaukee Comic Con, the Mighty Con. It's way more toys. Way more toys.
Right.
I talked to Jeff Balk, the guy who does the coloring. He's always at the DuPage and the Milwaukee cons and all that stuff. He's usually got that like big end booth.
Mm-hmm.
He is not really doing books anymore. He's just going to be doing he's not going to be doing prints much. He's got an animation studio, and he's working with a former Disney animator who used to work on who worked on like Aladdin, who worked on Little Mermaid. So they're getting things started in that aspect. And I was like, that's dope. I talked to one more round. They're finishing their pitch for getting their book picked up for, you know, a studio so they could write and get the art done. And basically somebody could pay for the art so that it can get done.
Right.
And I told them, like, hey, if you don't get any bites on that, like, let's go to Kickstarter. Like, we can make you a video. We'll get it done. We'll get it done. Because I feel like I really want their trade. And they said their story is 12 issues. And I was like, don't make anything less than a 12-issue trade.
Right.
He's like, the story is 12 issues. And I was like, I don't know if we're going to do, like, 4 or if we're going to do 6. And I was like, well, how long is the storyline? He's like, 12. I'm like, do 12.
Right.
I'm like, I'll wait for 12.
Yeah, no, absolutely do 12. I mean, we're not going to talk about it.
No, but I told them all about that. I told them all about, what is it? Treadwater?
Treadwater.
Treadwater.
Listen, let's
pull that up and see if they're even a thing anymore.
I mean, they are because they still are posting, but.
I don't understand how you're going to come through with such a huge, huge push, right? It's like,
well, not only
here's a video game, here's all this. And
you're talking about an actor, right? Somebody that's been known now, right? And you have this guy, and you're telling me in the first trade, he's not even in it? Like, how are you?
That's convinced? What I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Their big pitch was like, oh, this character, he's got this great weapon and his arm with the suitcase. And I was like, awesome. And then you get to the last page and I was like, I'm sorry, what?
Nothing.
I was so mad, dude.
Yeah, even I told you when I read it, I was like, dude, he's not even in there. And you're like,
whatever is wrong with their Facebook page is still wrong. I don't know, man. Facebook. Their last post on Facebook was January 21st.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe they're not around anymore.
I mean, like, they might be working on stuff, but...
Or they might not be around anymore.
It says August 11th. Okay, well, that's weird. It's not in order, apparently. Is there a way to, like, show most recent, not stupidly old stuff? August 10th. I just see, like, some artwork, and that's cool.
Yeah, but, no, it's basically, that's the example that I have. Like, if you're going to do something, if you're going to try to push something, push it the right way. Don't play this, like, game, oh, well, we wanted to go far. We want this to be a continuous thing. That's great, but you don't put, like, if you're pushing something, hey, we got this guy. He's well known. We made a character about him. He's in the comic, and then he's not in the comic.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
You did something wrong. You had my attention, and then you just completely gone.
What photo do we post? Did you post the photo?
Of course I did. I always post stuff.
Oh no! This was. We just got a like on... That's cool. That's cool. We just got a like on the 780T photo that you took when you first got it.
Oh, snap. Wow.
Yeah. I was like, why? Like, what photo did we just post? No, like, that's cool. See, like... And that's the kind of stuff I like to see. Is like, you know what? Like, yeah, we don't have a ton of subscribers or whatever, but like, we have people watching it, and we have people looking at our posts, and we have people that like our stuff months, years after we've done them. I like it. It's cool. People are finding the information. That's kind of the thing to me, is like, I feel, did you see this? This computer page on Facebook shared that video I did with
yeah.
I thought it was awesome. I was like, this is dope.
I thought that was great. Listen, it's the reason we're doing these videos is to get the word out. People just need to understand what's going on.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's why I like the One Wednesdays, man. I really like those videos, just because I feel like it's quick information that like people can absorb. Like, you can, oh, this is what it does. This is what it is. Cool. Like, you don't need anything more than that.
Right, exactly.
Well, it's 10 o'clock. I feel like this has been like a 3-hour...
It is, man. We got to call it here. I think we've been on plenty of tangents. I think going back to our original conversation, it all needs to be taken in consideration. I think that's how it works.
I think you got to let people make their art. And then, yes, after the fact, you can make observations. You can make... I just don't like the idea of the outrage.
Like, no, the outrage is absurd. Make
your feedback. Make your feedback, but make it constructive. Hey,
yeah.
This is what I didn't like about this. This is why. This is maybe how you could improve it in the future. Thank you for your movie. Have a great day. Thank you for your video game. Have a great day.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, that's why I like, because I've seen that people, you know, like on G-Shift, for instance, people have been like, hey, I like this. I like this. I didn't like this. This, you know, it'd be cool if it was this. I like right. that versus the guy who was like, this is literally what I could do when you press the space bar to jump, make a sandwich, and just like makes an absurd list of things, you know, things he could supposedly do while the jump happens.
Which clearly is impossible.
Right. I'm like, well, sir, I think you need to share your secret with people.
I mean, if you're the Flash.
Right. Listen, Barry.
you need to tell people. You need to tell people because we need to start, you know, realizing our potentials.
And I think we're going to leave it on that for realizing our potentials.
for realizing our potentials.
Realizing our potentials. So appreciate you guys for watching and or listening.
Listening. Yeah, man, this is a long. I don't think anybody's going to watch this video, but I hope they listen to the podcast.
I hope so. I hope they get some information, have some thoughts. Make sure you guys check out youtube.com/T3G Tech. If you want to check out some random game streams once in a while. YouTube or twitch.tv/T3G Gaming.
Correct.
Facebook/T3G Media. Yeah, it's T3G Media. Yeah. Instagram, T3G Media. Twitter is T3G Media. Yeah. Check us out. Give us a shout out. If you listen to the podcast, we really appreciate you. This is our third one, and
we're working on it little by little.
We're just coming up with some stuff.
Yeah, we think this is going to be a good way of doing them. You know, this is our norm. This is what we do. We converse for so long, and everybody's like, just make it into a podcast, make it into a video. So we're giving it a try. Hope you guys liked it.
Thank you for watching, listening, and we'll see you, and you'll hear us
in the next
to you guys next time.
Yeah.